Okay, so Remy, come on up. Something that we wanted to do was give sort of a case study as a keynote as well. And what better company to do that with than Twitter? We thought most of you tweet. Does everyone here have a Twitter account or tweets on a somewhat consistent basis? I think most everyone does. I certainly do. And Remy, wonderful human being, what a great guy, was nice enough to join us from San Francisco. You made a long trip yesterday, so thanks for making the trip. And we look forward to your presentation. Thank you. Yep.
Thanks, buddy. Come on, quick. All right. Can everybody hear me? Hi there, everybody. Good morning. So I'm thrilled to be back around here. Prior to my role at Twitter, I was a Red Hatter, so I wasn't too far away over in Raleigh. It's great to be back in the East Coast, especially in the South. See all y'all, right? So today, I'm going to try something a little different. This is my first time running through this deck, so bear with me. We've been dealing with some technical issues. That's what you do whenever you get up to give one of these things. But this is an infographic. I made it, so if there's issues, I'm not a designer by trade. Very early in my career, I learned how to use this tool called Inkscape, which is like the open source version of Adobe Illustrator. So we put this together with the help of some of the folks at Twitter on all these different projects. The goal here is to talk about the on-ramp to open source hiring. So when I got a chance to speak to this audience, I figured, okay, how many people here already get paid to work on open source? Okay, maybe 10%. How many people here would like to get paid to work on open source? Okay, that's more like 60%. Great. So this keynote is an opportunity for me to share some of the things that are working for us to get people paid in open source, because, hey, I started out, I had to do, 3 or 4 years of unpaid work in nonprofits and in internships and in volunteerships to get the experience I needed. And I had my gone with the wind moment of saying, no one will ever work for free for open source in my shops ever again, right? I will not go hungry again. So what I wanted to do throughout this presentation is give you some actionable things you can do. If you have Twitter, a lot of these nodes that we're gonna go through in the step ladder, they have Twitter accounts that you can follow immediately that also have links to application processes and different programs that you can join. So this graph, sort of the way that it works, and I didn't really get a good chance to introduce all of myself either. So my name is Remy DeCosmaker. I'm the open source program manager over at Twitter. It is an incredible role. I get to help hackers work together, use their powers for good. It's incredible. Twitter is a big company. We're hiring. My team is hiring. Please come and talk to me after this if you're interested. But before we get to that part of it, I want to take a minute to talk about these different layers. So before you even get to college, there's a lot of effort put into getting college students to the point where they can contribute to open source, right? But before you even get there, that's when a lot of people need to get their head start. As long as you're starting early, that's usually one of the biggest indicators for people to find their passion and get the skills that they really need. And one of the earliest orgs that you can work with is a handle, code.org. Anybody heard of this place? Hadi Partovi and a bunch of his brother started this nonprofit to help get CS into high school programs, get it accepted as part of the standard curriculum. They do some incredible work in that space. Highly recommend to give it a follow and check it out, because at the beginning of the pipeline, really code.org is some of the earliest education for children to get involved in open source. And they run this program called Hour of Code. An Hour of Code is just like it sounds. It's 1 hour CS class for students to get involved in open source for the first time. They have a Minecraft module, and they had a Disney Frozen module, and they had all these different lessons that kids could pick up that were very interesting and exciting for them. And at the end, you can print out a little certificate. I did it with my nephews over Thanksgiving break a couple years ago. Highly recommend it. Don't even need a computer. You can just do it through the web browser, even on a mobile device. So moving along, once you get into the high school range, First robotics competition is something that a lot of students can find their way. So if you've got someone in your family that is interested in getting involved in hardware, First Robotics is a great place to start. And they hold these like, you know, sort of soccer games and all these other types of challenges where students build open source hardware and use open source software to power it. It's very powerful, and it's a great way to get involved as a mentor. So even before you get into college, you can start contributing to open source anytime. And there's an event called Hacktoberfest, which is co-sponsored by GitHub and DigitalOcean and a few others, I think, which basically says, hey, if you submit 5 pull requests this month, we'll send you a t-shirt. It's a pretty simple thing. This was the 5th year that they ran it. And I think there was something like 60,000 people that participated. So it's absolutely incredible. And it can be to any open source project. That open source project just needs to register. You can get all the details at Hacktoberfest. So those are some of the things that, from a pre-college standpoint, that you can be doing to get into the pipeline and get started early. Once you get into the college side of things, there are a lot of really well-established open source onboarding programs that can help not just to get technically talented students into the pipeline, but also diverse and inclusive candidates. Great prior keynote, Tracy, absolutely a very important thing in tech to improve the ratio, and a couple of these programs are really doing a great job with that I'll get to in a second. The first one I want to talk about is Major League Hacking. So it's actually ML Hacks is the name of the handle. Major League Hacking is kind of like the NCAA version of hackathons. They run something like 250 hackathons across North America every year. Typically, we have between 800 and 1,000 attendees. UNC has Pearl Hacks, I believe, right at Chapel Hill, which is an all-women's hackathon that they've been hosting there for 2 or 3 years now. And that's an MLH event officially. So if you're a college student, you can go and compete in these hackathons, which are sponsored by companies that have, you know, Alexa from Amazon. They give everybody a device, and you can go and try and make a cool Alexa app. And there's a competition and a contest category for that. Or, you know, different APIs and different challenges, and there's classes. And MLH, you could spend a whole talk just talking about all the stuff that MLH does. They are an incredible resource, and if you don't already have a hackathon that's running at your school, MLH can help to set you up with advocates and sponsors and all kinds of things to help you get one running at yours. So outside of the hackathon space, there are a lot of these, there are more and more of these open source onboarding paid internship programs. And one of the first ones to come out was from our friends at Google. So at GSOC, you can follow them. The deadline for this next session is actually tomorrow. So hey, if you really are hard up and you're looking for some paid work over the summer, you can still apply. I've been a mentor for Google Summer of Code twice. I've been an organizational admin once. TLDR, work for about 1 quarter on a remote paid internship on open source projects. So you get, I think it's $6,000 roughly, about it's paid some up front, some in the middle, and some at the end. The idea is that any open source project can apply to Google. So these aren't just Google's open source projects, right? So organizations apply, and then once those projects get accepted, they open applications to students. Students can apply to join those programs, get hired as interns working remotely, and that also helps the projects identify core contributors potentially, or new project leaders, or potential hires as well. Because some open source projects have companies, like consulting companies, behind them, and they're always looking for great talent. So super shout out for Google Summer of Code. They're like the triple OG onboarding program in the space. I think they've been going for like 15 years now or something like that. It's really something. They started a new one. One of the big things that people have been talking about in open source is that, open source is more than code, right? It's community, it's design, it's documentation. So Google Open Source announced they're going to do a new thing called Google Season of Docs. So I'm not sure, citation needed, but I think that any technical writer, you don't have to be a college student, can apply to be a Google Season of Docs participant, and it works in a very similar way. Projects apply, those projects get accepted, students can apply to submit docs for those projects. There's a bonding period before they start over the summer, And then in the fall, you work on the project. It's paid work to write docs for open source projects. And documentation is a great place to get introduced to a project, right? If you want to get a good overview of what a community looks like, the docs are usually the place that you start. And just because you're a new contributor, a lot of people say, well, I don't know anything about the project. What can I really contribute? That first flow where you go through the docs and you try to install something, that is a perspective that anybody who's written the docs before doesn't have, right? They have all these assumptions. They know a lot of context about the project. So as you're going through, if you run into anything, even the issues you run into, reporting problems, are a contribution in themselves, right? So once you figure out what's wrong with the docs, then you can fix that. Once you figure out how to fix the docs, maybe those are sitting next to the code. So now you can figure out how to fix the code, and you're off to the races, right? So the pipeline isn't just about, you know, the tech pipeline. The pipeline is about introducing people to communities and opportunities and letting them find their own passions. And Seasons of Docs, I think, is a great way to get some sort of non-traditional contributors involved and to help spread that out. Really interesting program. Again, a whole nother talk could be done just on those types of programs that they're doing. So great job, Google. Another one that is really awesome is sort of a blend of what I've been talking about and what Tracy's been talking about, which is this program called Outreachy. It was put on by the GNOME Foundation. It started out as the outreach program for women, and they have since expanded it to include underrepresented people in open source, female identifying, also non-binary, and lots of other underrepresented folks. So this is all over the world. It runs year-round. And depending on whether you're in the northern or the southern hemispheres, you get to apply for different parts of the year. So this program I've been a mentor for a couple of times now. Highly recommend it. It's paid work. The community of folks that come into it are amazing. That's the same ringtone as I have. I just had a panic for a second. It's a great program. It gets people involved. And then that alumni group is still there. There's LinkedIn groups. There's places where you can then tap into this pipeline after you've gone through the mentorship process and hire some of these folks that have been doing this work in open source. So my color coding, I didn't really talk too much about, but this one's blue. Blue means it's one of ours, right? So I've talked a lot about other onboarding programs that we use to get people involved in open source. One of the ones that we use internally is capstone projects. So college students, especially CS students, often have a final senior project that they need to do to graduate. It gives them work experience and practical experience. Often it's work for hire with local companies. I would recommend any local businesses to reach out to your departments and find out if there are senior class projects like this, because many, many universities are looking for partners just like the people in this room. So we worked with the University of San Francisco, USF. They have a CS senior class. They have to do final projects, and we pitch various things in our open source community. So Twitter has, you know, over 100 repos on GitHub. So some of those have grown and been graduated out of the nest. So we go to those projects. We pick some low-hanging fruit off of their issue tracker and their backlog, and we pitch it to the students, and we say, you know, working as a team part-time for the semester, we think that you can get about this much done. So when we pitch these projects, the students also, you know, they're open source. So their work is out there in the community for people to see. It's not just going into some professor's Dropbox and being run through the, you know, plagiarism checker and then never seeing the light of day again. This is real code that works in production in some cases. And, you know, we had a team that submitted 3 patches to our core microservices stack while they were college students, never having looked at our stuff before. And that was merged before they even finished the semester. So people are contributing directly to our products from the classroom, and capstone projects are a great way to identify that. And when we pitch the capstone projects, it's actually based off of best practices, aka we just take the application for Google Summer of Code and the application for Outreachy, mix them together, and then use that as a way for us to identify shovel-ready projects that we can pitch to capstone students. Those same shovel-ready projects that would take a team of 3 working part-time, 5 hours a week, probably will work out as a rotation for an internship, right? So by utilizing this pipeline and sticking to the best practices, you can plan for these things to move along. So our capstone projects, we say, okay, we're going to get this far with the students during the spring, and then in the summer, they can pick up the baton where those students left off. Before you know it, you've got an actual pipeline, right? People are contributing to the project. You're identifying them as interns, that you're getting them to apply to the program. And then when they get hired, they can do rotations on real-world problems inside of the company. And I don't want to get too deep into that because I'm going to be giving a talk later on today. So if you want to hear more about all of the stuff that we're doing, not just at the college level, but overall, you can come and check us out there. I think it's at 11:30. I don't know. I don't have the schedule in front of me. Great. So let me just go back to the big picture one more time. How much time do I have left?
About 5 minutes.
Great. So the point of putting this all in one giant graphic was so that you could get an idea of the bigger picture, right? So notice that a lot of these spaces are empty, right? I don't know all of the great ways to get involved in open source. There are lots of onboarding programs. These are just the ones that I know of that we've worked with. So this is a repo. It's on GitHub. If you know of other projects that should be included or other onboarding programs, let us know. We can add them to this list, right? Any of the sort of steps that have a blue square in them, this means that this is a mentorship opportunity. So after you've gone through this pipeline of building the students up to get to that entry-level bar in the middle, there's also another season where you have your core contributors and your lead engineers, and they want to grow their career as well. They would like to have opportunities to mentor and show and learn, right? So any of these blue squares are places where the people that we work with and then go back and participate. So even if you can't apply as a Google Summer of Code student, you can apply to be a Google Summer of Code mentor. And that is another great way to get involved in open source. And you don't have to be a college student to do that. Anybody can be a mentor. So all these blue squares are places where mentorship can happen. And we encourage not just the hiring pipeline and not just the onboarding pipeline, but the mentorship pipeline as well. So if you put all those things together, you can start to imagine that you're building a more sustainable ecosystem that brings in inclusive hires, make sure that you got the work going that actually needs to be done, and then the people afterwards are invested, right? Because it's not just about the tech, right? It's about the people. The code is an artifact, right? It's stagnant. It can be obsolete. It's always going to be aging out. But communities, that's what adapts. That's what thrives. That's where the real value in open source lies. Don't let me get started on that. But rather than take the full last 5 minutes here, I think I'll end a little bit early, give folks some time back. We are sort of known for brevity at the company. Probably already have not done a great job. But thank you, Todd. Thank you, organizers. These are the contact info for us. You can find the deck on GitHub, opensource@twitter.com, if you want to drop an email. I'm Remy_D, if you want to follow me. And at Twitter OSS is where we have our open source program, so you can follow the updates there. Like I said, we are hiring right now, so come talk to me if you are someone who is interested in being a technical lead or you have experience in OSPOs. We need all the help we can get, right? These are big problems, and all the people in here are going to help us figure it out, and we don't even know the next person to come about. That's why these onboarding programs are so important. So thank you all, and I will see you throughout the day.